Hi, my name is Eric Price, and I'm the director of the Nevada Film Office. Today I'm sitting down with Carl Ciarfalio. Thank you for being here.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Carl, you are a stuntman, stunt coordinator. You've been in this business how long?
About 45 years. Yeah.
How did you get in this thing?
I was going to college, and I was on a wrestling team.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the guys on the wrestling team, we became fast friends. All he could talk about was Yakima Canutt and John Wayne and doing stunts. And all I wanted to do was learn how to ride the motorcycle. We got to be buddies, and we kind of hanging out together. And he got us an audition at Knott's Berry Farm.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to start a stunt show out there, and they needed a couple of guys, and they're looking for a big guy who could move and be funny.
Mm-hmm.
And I was digging ditches for a plumber, and I thought, why not give it a shot?
Yeah, right.
And so I auditioned. He taught me a little scene and a little fight, and auditioned, and I was 20 years old.
Wow.
And, you know, found myself learning a little bit, learning the show, and 20 years old, on stage, cowboy hat, gun, people are applauding, people are laughing, pretty girls in the audience.
Could be worse.
I was just like, yeah, I'll go back to school one day.
Mm-hmm.
And I just fell in love with, I fell in love with the action. I fell in love with the movement, the learning process, the acting, and haven't looked back.
45 years goes by and you're like, where did it go?
Flying, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So you were a physical athlete, and then that just lended itself to, hey, what about this business? And how does it work? You know, just for people that maybe aren't as familiar, kind of the structure of a film set, television set, stunt professional, and what's that next level and the next level? What's that look like?
Well, good question. Stunts, action stunts, the physicality on set on a production, it comes in all shapes and forms and sizes.
Mm-hmm.
It might be everything from a push or a slap to being lit on fire or crashing a car.
Yeah.
So a production company will always hire a stunt coordinator, and that stunt coordinator hopefully knows his or her stuff, and that stunt coordinator will break down the stunts, the action, and then pull in either nondescript stunt people to play those parts, or sometimes we'll pull in stunt people to read for a role.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also responsible for the stunt doubles for our actors.
Oh, okay.
So as a stunt coordinator, there's so much to know, not just how to break down the script and how to budget, but you need to know safety, and you need to know what's going to happen, the best possible guess.
And that stunt coordinator is so vital to the production.
Yeah.
Because all of the complexities, from the very simple, like you said, to the very complex, safety being a very important issue, it's that stunt coordinator's responsibility to keep everyone safe.
Yeah, most definitely. Not that we use it very often, but a stunt coordinator has the ability to shut down a production.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not safe, somebody has to make that call. You'll find producers that'll push.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, can't we just do it once? Or can't we just make the explosion a little bigger? Can't we get a little closer to the fire?
Yeah.
And as a stunt coordinator, you need to know what the limits are.
Yeah.
And because it's never worth anybody being hurt or killed.
Right.
It shuts down everything. And you don't want that to happen.
And that, I got to imagine, that is probably the toughest position to be on set, right? You're telling the producer, hey, I know it's costing X thousands of dollars per minute here, but this ain't right.
Yeah, I just got off the phone yesterday with a little phone production meeting director, a unit production manager, line producer, and one of the producers. And they said, okay, and then in this one scene, we're gonna pull in four police cars while we have people crossing the street and want them to come in hot. And I said, okay, so that's four stunt people.
Mm-hmm.
And you heard this pause. You heard the budget going through their head.
Yeah.
And they said, no, I don't think we can do that. And I said, so if you're not gonna bring the stunt people in, then we need to establish the cars that are there. We can't be pulling cars in with people who are may not be qualified. So those are the little things that you have to overcome with the production.
Yeah.
You have to say, no, this isn't right. So if you want to do it like this, there's stunt people. Or if you want to do it like that, then we'll put background extras in that position.
And that's based on your experience and as your knowledge as a coordinator, but is it also based on standards and SAG and regulation as far as like how a film set is supposed to be run?
Good question. There's SAG sets some, Screen Actors Guild sets some parameters. OSHA also sets some parameters. Mm-hmm. And I think that I think there's a common sense that goes
sure.
with that as well.
But that industry experience and that knowing you can't do that.
Sure.
But it again, it puts you in that role, that difficult role of having to say, this, we can't do that.
I learned a long time ago, I was doing a stunt in down in the Yucatan at Chichen Itza on a movie called Against All Odds. And I'm playing a dead guy, and I got mm-hmm. pushed off a cliff. We did 65 feet flat into water. And the stunt coordinator said, we need a helicopter because if something happens to this guy, we're in the middle of the jungle.
Yeah.
And the producer said, nah, I don't know. I don't think we can get a helicopter.
Because they're always worried about the budget.
That's right. And so he said, well, I'm walking. And he turned around and walked. And I went, all right, I get it now. You know, my life, whoever you put in that position,
right,
much more important than that $5,000 I needed for the helicopter.
Yeah.
So as he walked, I turned and walked with him, and they got the helicopter.
The relationship between a coordinator and the professionals that work with them, that's an important relationship because you're looking out for each other's well-being.
You have to. And we're not just in charge of the people that we hire or work with. We're in charge of the whole set.
Mm-hmm.
So if you've got a car flying through, or if you've got a guy coming in that's on fire, you got a woman coming down the stairs, you just need to take a look at all the big things and then the little things, because the little things are what.
And every extra that's in the vicinity that could get hurt if this goes south or whatever.
Or any extra that wants to jump in and be part of it. You know,
mm-hmm.
you do big crowd scenes and you can see
do.
Big eyes and white knuckles. Somebody wants to get in there.
Yeah.
And you're like, okay, so we take this guy and we'll put him back here.
Put him in the back. Yeah. We've seen that on some productions. Yeah.
You just have to be aware, you know. And as a stunt coordinator, you want to surround yourself with the people that you don't have to watch.
Mm-hmm.
Eric, I need you to do da-da-da.
Yeah.
I'm going to be over here rigging this guy.
Yeah.
I don't want to have to worry about you.
Yeah.
So to be a stunt professional, you need to know that when you're put in a position, it's not just your gag that you're doing, but it involves everything that's around you.
Yeah. So say you're on a production and you do raise a red flag and they say to you, well, we don't think that's that important. And so then it's kind of your decision. You just have to walk, or do you do anything with that info? Because do you worry that, and this is just a personal thing, do you worry that, okay, I'm not comfortable with this, and then you think if I leave this production, they'll just get someone else who is, and it'll go south, and it's just, is it not your problem, or, I mean?
Well, you know what, and that happens all the time. You know, if you're too expensive, we'll get somebody that'll say yes to the budget.
Right?
And you do get what you pay for, you know, on a
mm-hmm.
production.
Then you're not working and someone else is, and
yeah.
that's a struggle,
but
too.
I've had conflicts with producers, and I think also you need to take a look at what the producers are looking at, why they're looking at it that
mm-hmm.
way. And if it's absolutely can't be done, or if I feel absolutely as a stunt coordinator that somebody's going to get hurt or killed, much more important for me to walk away and lose a job than it is to put somebody in that position.
Yeah.
Very tough as a coordinator after all these years for what I've done is to put somebody in a position that is dangerous.
Then you got to live with that if something goes south.
Yeah, so we
so you
need
just
got to
walk.
Yeah, we need to know. Very tough to put somebody in those positions and make sure all your bases are covered. And if you do, you don't want a producer on the other end tapping his toe.
Yeah.
You know, you need to go in full power. It's a team effort, but you need to know your stuff.
They need to respect what you're doing, and you try to understand where they're coming from and find a way that everybody is happy and the production can continue on.
It's it takes a village, man.
It does, right? Yeah, I mean, this sure is a collaborative does. Effort.
Well, you know, when you see 100, 125, 150 people working on a set and two-thirds of them are sitting down, you know, you might, from the outside, you might go, wow, these guys are getting paid a lot of money to do what?
Yeah.
But when the whistle blows, when somebody yells action, when the clapboard hits, there's 150 people up and doing what they need to do, even if it only takes 10 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, because it's all so important.
How have you seen the industry change with just content being created at lower budget levels, more independent films, the pressure, downward pressure on these budgets to do more with less? How have you seen that just in your experience kind of affect? Because you've worked on the biggest things.
The biggest.
And we could do a whole podcast just about the things that you've worked on and listen to you tell cool stories. So you've worked on the biggest, but you've also worked on some of the small independent
stuff. Smaller budgets ever. Yeah. I think the change started coming right around, the mid-90s. CGI came in, a lot of electronics came in that changed the ability to make movies. You used to have to have X amount of money and a studio behind you to do it, and now you need two GoPros and an iPhone.
Right.
And, you know, and you can make a movie.
People are doing it.
You know, if you look back at Kevin Smith, you know, he did it with Clerks?
Yep.
With Clerks,
yeah.
And then
now he's doing Iron Man and Marvel and, you know, all that stuff.
And so it can be done. It can be done right. The thing about budgets is that you still need to have a budget.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's all over the board, Eric. It's like, you know, do you want to hire De Niro for $5 million for the day?
right.
Or do you want to hire Joe for $1,000 for the week? You know, it's kind of like that. There budgets fly all over the place. The ability to make smaller budget shows now is good. It's out there. It's available to for people to do. But there's still a quality that needs to come with it.
Yeah.
If you don't have the quality, if you don't have the sound, if you don't have the – it just cuts right
we
in.
We talked to a line producer here, Marco Henry, local, who said every movie can be done at every budget. It's just a matter of what you want to get on the screen at the end of the day. But everything can be done at every budget level.
You bet.
It's just what do you want it to look like when you're done.
Yeah.
And just with your profession, with stunts and with safety being so important, this downward pressure on budgets, everyone's looking to cut costs. And it's like, oh, well, yeah, we don't need to pay these rates for this experienced professional. Let's get someone else in there. And that's where the trouble is. So I think, you know, that stuff rolls downhill.
Sure.
And areas get cut that shouldn't get cut. That's where the problems come in.
That's part of as a stunt coordinator, when you sit at a production meeting and they say, okay, we've got, you know, four cars in a chase, one guy gets hit, one car jumps and goes and lights on fire.
Yeah.
And you go, okay, well, that's going to cost you this amount of money. And they go, well, we can't pay that. And then you just take those pages and you throw them away. And they said, okay, well, we won't do that. And they're like, well,
but we want to do it.
You know, so let's sit down and figure out a way that we can do this. A lot of camera tricks.
Yeah.
A lot of safety tricks. You know, I was coordinating a show back in Chicago a few years back and did a car hit with an actor. And we did it in cuts. Didn't have the budget to get a double.
Mm-hmm.
So we did it in cuts, and it looks great. There's so many things you can do if you just past that first initial knee-jerk reaction.
But that's such a great point. A professional stunt coordinator...
It's probably for me.
Not a professional like me who doesn't turn his phone off, but a professional stunt coordinator can look at a scene and say, well, you don't have the budget for this to do it safely. So let's look at how we can do it safely at your budget level, and knows the tips and the tricks and the ways to get it done. And that's the value. That's why someone needs to hire a professional.
Can I stop you there? Eric, let's take it back to that question.
Okay.
From the beginning.
Well, I'm trying to remember what the question was now. And I apologize.
That's okay. Safety, experience coordinators.
Yeah. Okay. So experience coordinators.
Okay.
So, you know, an experienced coordinator can take a look at a scene and say, we can't do that safely. Here's an alternative that we can do safely. And that's why hiring a trained stunt, a professional, makes a huge difference.
Yeah, you're exactly right. And the part of the problem with my industry is there's no qualifications.
Really?
I don't have a certificate that says Carl's a stunt coordinator. You know, I just don't have one of those. Because we come from so many backgrounds. I mean, maybe I'm coordinating a show next week and I need eight surfers.
Mm-hmm.
I need to find surfers, you know. I don't know if I need to find guys who crash cars.
Yeah.
I need to find those guys who can also surf.
Yeah.
So we come from all kinds of backgrounds. And a lot of us, as we come into the industry, will learn more. And as you learn more, you progress, you know. I mean, when I came in, I knew how to do fights and high falls. But I learned cars and motorcycles, fire, you know, you name it. You have to know it. And to get an experienced coordinator on a low budget is tough.
Mm-hmm.
But there's some of us that I love little shows. It becomes such a family. It becomes so integrated with everybody working together.
Yeah.
Sometimes you don't need 100 people. Sometimes 30 is enough.
It's great to work with people that are passionate about what you're doing.
And smart.
And smart. You
know, sometimes passion can overflow.
Yeah.
So, but that's
passion can cause the problems we were talking about.
That's right. So that's when you put the reins on, you know, and that from the beginning of the shoot, from the production meetings forward, that's the communication you keep open.
Mm-hmm.
Because those things change. When I was doing a Stallone picture in Florida, and I've still got the script. I've got a script that's got more colors of pages than I've ever seen before.
Mm.
Every time they change a script page, they change the colors.
Yeah.
So I've got a rainbow. And as a coordinator, you need to be on top of that.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, one day this guy's going out the window, and the next day this guy's going to be lit on fire.
Yeah.
So you need to know that and be on top of it. Yeah, be on production all the time.
It sounds like so much of your work is not even on set. It's, you know, there might be the misconception that the stunt professionals show up, do the stunt, and go. But there's so much of it that is in the planning stages and in the reading and rereading of the script and coordinating all that that happens, and no one knows it happens behind the scenes.
Well, it's all the prep work. It's like anything else. If you're going to paint, you know, you prep.
Yeah, right.
It's just as simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
And when you prep, You prep for not only the beginning and the middle, but you also prep for the end of whatever that guy is going to be.
Yeah.
You know, so everybody walks in safe and walks out safe.
Yeah, yeah. You know, all that preparation is what leads to a successful shoot. But people don't necessarily see all that preparation or maybe necessarily compensate for all that preparation. But that's what makes it so there is no news story about someone getting hurt on set or something, or bad publicity from someone getting injured or just someone getting injured.
So I think you're right. There's a lot of the misconception out there that, you know, we go in there and break things and cut ourselves up and break our bodies and they shove us away and put somebody else in.
Yeah.
Not really like that, you know. Mm-hmm. It's very tough to have a long career anyway. And if you can last 20 years or better, you know, you're doing okay.
Yeah,
But you have to be able to last that long. You can't do that by not thinking.
And as we wrap up here, because it goes by so quick,
yeah.
I mean, I could talk to you forever. Technology is changing the way the industry works.
Sure.
And the using of technology so you don't have to break your body over and over and over.
CGI wires, the rigging that goes on these days.
Mm-hmm.
Mocap. And that's happening here in Las Vegas as well. We got great talent here. We got some really wonderful people who are on the cutting edge of making movies. So the more that happens, hopefully the more movies will be made and based here. Looking forward to that a lot.
Yeah, that's exciting. Again, Carl, I could really talk to you so long. We haven't even talked about your book. Can we just show the book, honestly?
I didn't
even think about it, but I want to show it now that
that's
we're
okay.
Because
how are we doing? We out of here?
We're
out of time.
Because right. I mean, that's 45 years of your life. And people love these stories. We didn't even get into the stories. People love the stories.
You know, and they're fun stories to read because they're not really long. I'm a big Reader's Digest kind of guy.
Mm-hmm.
Read it, get it, and go, you know?
Yeah.
But you know what? Maybe we're off, right?
No, we're going.
Are we still going?
Yeah.
All
we're
right.
going to go as long as we need to go.
Cool. Well, it's called Star Stunts and Stories, A Hollywood Stuntman's Fall to Fame. And I wrote it. I started in the early 2000s. I'd been injured, and I had both my hips replaced, and I was recouping. And my buddies would come over, and we would tell story.
Yeah.
And my wife, who's a writer, said, "You know what? These stories, it's history, and it's individual. It's not like everybody shares the same experience or sees it the
same way." How many people can say, "Oh, on the set of Casino, yeah. De Niro, you know, did this to me"? And
so I started writing, and then wrote a little bit, and then put it away, and wrote a little bit, and put it away, and then finally, a few years ago, once again, I was recouping from something, and we put it together and printed it up, and I'm having fun success.
Is
with
it that. Like on Amazon, the website,
Amazon,
and all
Amazon.com, and if you catch me through Facebook, I'll sign one and send it to you. You know, so
we'll have to do another one and just talk about that. I mean, I didn't even think about it, and that's my bad.
Yeah.
I didn't think about it until I saw it there, and I know how many people enjoy hearing about it. So maybe we can do another.
I would love that. I keep it close, and I also on these interviews I keep my resume close because somebody will say,
right?
"Hey, in 1986, when you did this," I'd be like, flip through the pages a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, this is a pleasure, and I think at the end of the day, what we want to do here is we want people to know that you know, we get great talent here in Las Vegas,
yeah.
Southern Nevada, and we've got talent from one end to the other, and I can't wait to do more movies here. You know, I just produced one here,
yeah,
and called Blood from Stone, and it's coming out really well, and hopefully we'll have a couple more.
Well, I look forward to it. I appreciate you taking your time, sitting down. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Again, I'm Eric Price from the Nevada Film Office. I want to thank Carl for sitting down and sharing his experience in the industry, and I hope you enjoy. Thank you very much.